Hello everyone, welcome to DT Speak. My name is Tyron, and in this video I'll be taking a trip down memory lane back to the very first video game I ever played and finished. First, we need to cover some ground. In case you can't tell, I'll be reviewing the PC version of this game, which was built on the very first iteration of the Unreal Engine, although I can personally vouch for the PS2/Xbox/GameCube version as being far superior in almost every way. Sorcerer's Stone is an action-adventure platformer which, according to the game's executive producer, was targeted at gamers ages 8 to 14 for its puzzle-like gameplay. Although I'm twice the average target age, I was half that age the first time I picked this game up, and I remember it being very fun and challenging the very first time I played it, which was fair, again, considering that it was my first game. It took me around 2 years to finally meet the requirements for 100% completion. There is, however, a downside to all of this. This game is nearing 16 years old, and it is off the market, so you can't go out and buy it new. And it's not available through digital download by any legal means. It also doesn't run natively on modern machines because the copy protection was identified as a potential security threat and was discontinued. I had to cheat to get the game running on my machine just so I could capture my playthrough. And the final recorded time was 4 hours and 45 minutes. Nowhere near as long as I remember this game being. The game takes place at Hogwarts School, where you, as Harry, are obligated to attend your lessons and learn spells, earning house points for Gryffindor along the way. Let's take that whole last statement and tackle it segment by segment. Hogwarts! I wish that I could openly, fully, and non-linearly explore Hogwarts and its grounds, but instead the game is split up into completely linear levels, which I guess succeeds in capturing the feel from the corresponding book of individual episodic adventures, and each one has its own name, as is given by the load screen. And from what you can see of Hogwarts, it's not nearly massive enough to really feel like Hogwarts.
Oh wow, there's an actual ghost. Look at that.
Harry is the least verbal character in this game. He doesn't have much to say.
Wow.
Obviously, it wouldn't be Harry Potter if it didn't have spells, and the way you learn spells in this game is probably the most ludicrous thing in this game. Using your mouse, you need to trace a symbol of the spell you're trying to learn. I hope you have steady hands.
Did I just do it near perfect? Oh my gosh, I got it perfect!
Also, who knew you could gain up to 50 house points just for being proficient in a spell? Then 20 more for completing a challenge centered around that spell. And how does Hermione make sure you get those house points for learning Alohomora?
Great, Harry. I'm sure Professor Flitwick would give you 5 house points for that charm.
Why does she get to give you house points?
That makes no sense. So give it another go.
And finally, why are you the only Gryffindor capable of winning house points?
Hey, Harry, I won 5 points for Gryffindor today.
Oh, wait, I guess you're not? Either way, only your actions affect the score for Gryffindor, and it's not like there's any in-game mechanic that checks for house points because regardless, spoiler alert, Gryffindor will always win the house cup. However, if you want to shoot for maximum points, the amount to aim for is 342.
A further 3 points from Gryffindor should teach you a lesson.
Well, gee, thanks, Snape. Now, how do saves work? You can have up to 6 current playthroughs saved on your computer, which is awesome. And the game autosaves on every new level load. The game doesn't exactly have a way to manually save. Instead, it has a player-activated checkpoint system that I'll let Nick explain.
Now, this is a save game book. When you touch it, your game will automatically be saved.
Okay.
The game will restart from this point if you faint.
The game makes this work by throwing these books basically all over the place. And since it's an extremely linear game, you want to make sure that everything you don't want to have to redo should you die, is done before you save to protect yourself from complete frustration because these books don't respawn. Now, what are the chances of you actually dying? Well, this is a platformer. In some cases, if you don't time your jumps right, or if you mistakenly think that Harry can grab hold of the ledge, which sometimes he doesn't, you will fall to your death.
Whoa!
Oh, and I died. Oh well.
The only other way to die is by running out of health, and there are four actual boss fights throughout the game. Two encounters with Peeves the Poltergeist.
Aha! Surprise!
One with Malfoy.
This is as far as you'll be going. You won't get past me, no matter how hard you try.
And one with Voldemort. Pretty sure heads don't work like that. Where, if you're not careful, you could lose a decent chunk of health and potentially die. There are also several creatures that can take your health away. Spiky bushes, venomous tentacula, doxies, orange snails, fire-farting turtles, and the closest thing we get to combat outside of bosses, those pesky gnomes. Luckily, you also have chocolate frogs that replenish your health, and they're strategically scattered throughout the game. Just be careful around those gnomes, they might just steal your beans. That brings up the next point, collectibles. Collectibles are how you measure whether you'll get the completion bonus at the end of the game. The requirements are to collect 24 wizard cards and 250 excess Birdie Bots beans. Once you know where every single secret in the game exists, this won't be a problem. Basically, this means you only need to gather a grand total of 400 beans. Don't worry, the game is filled with them. And 18 wizard cards, because the twins take care of the rest.
Have you collected 25 beans?
Yes, I have.
Thanks for helping us out, Harry. Here's a wizard card then. Hope you don't have this one yet. Come on, George. We've got work to do.
George is the one talking. George is talking to himself.
Save the final chapter of the game, a lot of the actual puzzles are self-solved. And unless you deliberately miss something in a challenge, there's no reason to walk away with less than all the challenge stars. The puzzles at the end of the game, however, do require some thought if you've never played before, so pay attention. Then there's flying and Quidditch. Man, this used to be my favorite part of the game. There's even a bonus Quidditch Cup play mode where you play in 7 matches in order to win the house championship. But for the first time, and this might be just because this is the first time I've opted to change certain things, I found the controls extremely jittery and hard to get used to. Still, I consider it a plus that you do in fact have total control over your flying. Then there's the wonderful audio elements that will decide whether they want to work or not work on the spot, at least on newer computers.
Let's play Quidditch!
The dialogue is also rather clunky, coming from many of the main characters.
But there's no way Snape would try anything while Dumbledore's around.
But Dumbledore left 10 minutes ago for the Ministry of Magic in London.
Apart from Snape.
You're late for potions, Mr. Potter. Inexcusable, even for celebrities.
This isn't helped by the total lack of any lip sync.
I am Albus Dumbledore, your headmaster.
My glasses.
Apart from scripted dialogue, you can also get other generic students to talk to you by running into them.
You can't just go around bumping into people. It's rude.
Oh my gosh, you're right. I'm sorry. And to top it all off, you can interrupt what someone is saying by holding down the cast button.
Clever lad!
I do like the ambient sounds when they don't cause artifacts in my headphones, and the actual effects are spot on when they don't glitch out. I also enjoy the music, but it quickly gets repetitive and there's not enough of it. An adventure game wouldn't be complete without the plot, right? Well, much like the puzzles, the plot is practically non-existent until the final chapter. Yes, you get little glimpses here and there in narrated cutscenes, but they don't last very long, and then it's back to your lessons. I think the game is trying to make a bigger deal about Hagrid owning a dragon. After all, it dedicates more time to Norbert than the stone. Which then leads into a very well-designed stealth level that, for some reason, has always bugged out for me in at least one way. Mrs. Norris, Filch's cat, always gets stuck on trying to hop up onto one of the bookcases, which makes the level a little easier than it has any right to be. I think the only way to fix it would be to catch her attention, which I didn't. Now, if I were just rating the game on the final two chapters alone, it would get a solid 8. But I had to remember to grade the whole game, as well as those technicalities that make it harder for someone who doesn't already own the game to play it. And it damaged the game enough to say the final verdict for Sorcerer's Stone is a 6 out of 10. It is fun, but it hasn't aged very well at all. If you don't already own a copy of this game, the only way I can recommend you get this game is if you meet the following three criteria. 1, you can easily acquire the game for $5 or less. 2, you have the patience to make absolutely certain that it will run on your machine without critical issues. 3, you have young, aspiring computer gamers living in your home. This is a great game to start them on. But if you can't meet all of these conditions, then don't bother. Darth Tyran has spoken. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please click that like button. And if you wish to see more content coming to this channel, then please consider supporting me on Patreon. And don't forget to subscribe. I'll see you guys next time.